When I look around me in my work, which is the field of urban development, I see an increasing role of storytelling, not only in selling real estate, but also in complete urban areas, branding their newly defined character to targeted audiences of buyers, users, visitors. And these stories should trigger their imagination to see how they could live their ideal lives in those areas. And especially in areas that have not transformed yet, you know, or maybe still industrial areas, you need the future users to look beyond the existing situation and see a new future with themselves in it. But on the other hand, if we look underneath the surface of our cities, there is also something more fundamental changing in how they are being developed. And this requires a much more active involvement of all the different parties, not only real estate companies, but also all other organizations and businesses, and all of us as citizens. And in general, this is not really something that we are very much aware of. So apart from understanding like how we could live in a city, we also need stories and our imagination to be triggered about how we can make the city together. So this requires a whole new layer of storytelling to in urban storytelling, which are more stories about co-producing the city. Now, when I was a small child and I was imagining my own ideal future, I actually always saw this glamorous big city life. I would be a successful architect, celebrity-like businesswoman, with well-dressed designer sunglasses, and I would run from one meeting to fancy dinners and cocktail parties where I would meet fantastically interesting people. This is me. I grew up in one of the most rural, poor areas of the Netherlands, and I was very, very determined to make this glamorous life a reality. And as you can see, getting an architecture degree was least of the hurdles I had to take. But 20 years later, I was well on my way. I had graduated, moved to the big city, I'd grown my hair, and I was ready to start living my dream life. I had been to Japan, but then the economic crisis hit and I lost my first job soon after I'd started it. All the jobs had disappeared, and at the employment agency they told me that people like me, the architects, were hopeless cases, impossible to employ. So there went the dream image. It crumbled right in front of my eyes, everything that I had worked so hard for. But at the same time, as that image crumbled, I was forced to take a critical look at the system that had actually generated all these jobs, these clients, these buildings, and wonder, like, okay, how did it function, and how come it doesn't function anymore in the crisis? And there was one area in particular that grabbed my attention, and this was a large office district in Amsterdam where I'd been working during my graduation in one of the many call centers. And this was this typical office district with, 120 office buildings, but like small buildings in the middle of parking lots, car-oriented, only 9 to 5, very boring, and facing 30% vacancy rate. There had been ideas from the municipality to transform this area, but due to the crisis, they did not have the resources to do so. And at the same time, all these owners, there were 80 different owners of these buildings, there were a few hundred companies using the space there, renting the space there, 26,000 people working there. So a lot of people had something at stake, but they didn't have the information and the awareness, maybe, the organizational power to transform or upgrade that area either. But what fascinated me most about that area must have been the complete absence of glamour there in the big city. So I was a bit surprised, and I think that triggered a similar aspiration and determination in me as had my own future image had done. So I thought, wait a minute, This area, called Amstel 3, and I have nothing to lose and the world to win. We are a match made in heaven. So I thought, okay, I'll give it a try. I will activate these people in this area and get something done. So I started to talk with all these people, and after the first conversations, I realized that actually nobody gives much. Nobody gives much about urban development. It is not something that interests them in their daily lives. It's something distant, something abstract. So it wasn't really easy to engage them. And I see a few of you looking like, oh no, shit, Sherlock, of course nobody cares about this. But it made me wonder, you know, people were so busy. And they also didn't really feel the awareness, but also the sense of like agency to make a change in their everyday environment, even though they thought it was very boring. So this needed some serious campaigning first before I could do anything there. And this is where the storytelling came in, and the glamour again. It had to be a bit fun for me as well. So what if I could take these serious goals of the urban development of this area, you know, transforming these buildings from office to places to live, to work, to recreate, and the public space to make it more green, more nice for meeting people, for pedestrians, cyclists, and translate this into a more appealing manifesto that would wake these people up by claiming more glamour in our everyday lives. So I used metaphors to start the conversation, and I was demanding, for example, champagne on rainy Monday mornings, or I wanted rose scent next to exhaust fumes, and I wanted poetry next to annual reports. All these things to make all these people in the area aware of their everyday environment, rethink it, you know, imagine potential alternatives and engage in getting something done. And even though I wasn't working in the area, I felt a very strong and personal urge to get something done there. So I also wanted to trigger those other people on a very personal level as well. So after some first introduction on social media, I stepped out and I started to organize all kinds of interventions in the area, very guerrilla style, very small. And I used this to get in touch with the people there and to talk with them, step by step, build a network of more and more people who were joining in and getting their input, their ideas, their feedback on what we could do there. And at the same time, I made all kinds of collages that I used to talk with people from the municipality, with the real estate owners, the companies, to see like, okay, how, what is your idea about this area? And do we have anything in common? Are there any shared interest where we can start to build collaborative projects on? And I think in everything I did, the stories were very productive and they were active. And they were really not so much about branding Amstel 3 as a great place, but it was about branding the mission to turn it into a great place. Because after all, it wasn't a great place yet. And over time, I built a collective, actually, of very different parties. So companies, institutions, organizations, individuals. And we started to co-create future visions for the area and discuss topics like sustainability, mobility, livability. And the stories that I had used to send out and to make them think about the area now came back with real input, real ideas. So some stories were fine-tuned or were replaced because they were just conversation starters. It was very interactive and very flexible. And by then you could also see that the first real projects were being realized. And some of them I had played a role, but in most of them I hadn't. Which hurt a little bit in the beginning as an architect to have like overview. But actually it was a very good sign because it meant that something was starting to go on in that area. And it made me realize that I had to shift to another, like a next phase in the storytelling for this area. So where I had been like creating and telling all the stories myself, I shifted to collecting and facilitating and sharing initiatives from others. And it was more like becoming a platform for this. I was not no longer the face of the revolution myself. I was taking a step back and leading the attention to the area itself. We changed the name from the Glamour Manifest, which was about me in a way, to Zoo City, as Zoo being the local prefix for the southeast part of Amsterdam, where the area was located. And we just became a platform for local people and initiatives and ideas. And we did this not only offline, but also online by building an interactive online platform for this, where this whole process of what I now call collaborative urban development was being facilitated, where people could actually share their own visions, their own ideas, discuss them with each other, build coalitions, and share investments to get real projects done, building the new stories for Amstel 3. And at the same time, we could see that also a whole new kind of initiatives came to the area, because as the economy picked up again, also large-scale projects came to the area, developing big mixed-use blocks where the offices used to be. And this brought yet again a whole new layer of storytelling to what we were doing, because this was more about branding the future image of this area, because now people really had to start to envision themselves living in this office district. And this brought a very interesting dynamics with it, because you had all these small and big initiatives that could benefit so much from each other. You know, one bringing liveliness, bringing new target groups to the area, and the others having spaces available, expertise, investment power to get real projects off the ground together. And we organized a lot of events where we brought them together and tried to make new connections and maybe enable unexpected alliances for new projects. But I also saw that there was a risk there, because these big branding campaigns that were focusing on the future image of the area, they could possibly replace the smaller stories that had built up over time simply by overpowering them or not investing so much in them anymore. And that would be an extreme pity, because there is so much value in the existing energy and sense of ownership in that area, because there's where your area's resilience is. So many different shoulders that carry the area for different reasons, that is essential in case, for example, another crisis hits. But also imagine when you, as one of the first inhabitants, you rent an apartment there, you come to the area, how it would be if you would like be able to tap into this local network where a lot of initiatives and creativity is going on, and you can simply, you know, join in, but also feel invited and inspired to think about your own environment, share your own initiatives, and actually really shaping this new living environment where you just moved in. You know, that would be such a fantastic place to be in my eyes. And of course, I mean, after renting out or selling those apartments, the stories for Amstel 3 are not finished. I mean, on the contrary, this is where another phase is starting. So, you know, wrapping up, I think I learned four lessons that I can see are very relevant for storytelling in urban development. And this is, I think, the first one: to make it like really real and personal and relatable. Don't be too meta or too abstract, because it can easily become generic and boring and then appeals to nobody really. Also make it active and productive. It's not only about consuming the final image, it's about being a part of it, actively shaping it. But also be interactive and flexible, so your story is not the end result, it's about the others. And know when to shift from telling the story to becoming a platform where others can tell their stories. And last but not least, you know, add branding layers to the stories, enriching them, updating them, scaling them, but not replacing them, so that we can, you know, keep telling the stories with all the people, with all the projects that are going on at that specific point of time. Because when I think about it, my ideal image was not only about being well-dressed, having long hair. Well, it was for a large part about having long hair. But but it was also about this deeper creative aspect to it. I mean, I wanted to become an architect for a reason. I also wanted to go to the city because I felt the city was a place of creative freedom where you could play an active role in shaping it. And this is what I started to sense in Amstel 3 over time with the people there, that there's actually, especially when they start to realize that they can have an influence, they really more and more started to enjoy, to share their ideas. Some of them even told me that they wanted to become an architect when they were younger as well. And they really enjoyed thinking about these things and developing new ideas and initiatives. So our cities, they need, but also deserve all our ideas and initiatives to be part of it. And we need to do that by really actively engaging and creatively engaging all of us structurally. And, you know, we deserve that too. Thank you very much.